If you ever want me to send something to the parents about like bringing snacks or whatever, I'm happy to do that. I actually did send a text on Monday. Like I sat down and I like, got it all compiled. I'm just doing a lot. No one responded. So I was like, so I asked Cheryl, I said, did you get my text? And she said, no. And so I sent it from my computer and not everybody's house. The only thing I can figure is that maybe it's just stored it. So I, and I had in there, reach to make snacks, but can't just tell me what it was. And so I had in there. So I'm going to send another reminder of your text, but I'm happy to always receive anything.
Has been awesome.
Good.
Thank you.
Yeah. Horace and Lana are watching from home.
Who is it?
Horace and Lana are watching.
Ah, yeah. Good morning. Welcome to Country Bible Church. So glad you're here with us this morning. Thank you for joining us if you're live streaming today. It's great to be with you to worship the Lord. We're going to open up our service today with a reading from Psalm 119 as we've come and gathered here to worship. Psalmist says, "You have dealt well with your servant, O Lord, according to your word. Teach me good judgment and knowledge, for I believe in your commandments. Before I was afflicted, I went astray, but now I keep your word. You are good and do good. Teach me your statutes." Let's pray. God, we come to you with that very prayer, God, that you would teach us. You're the keeper of knowledge. All truth and wisdom is held in you by your hand. You give it generously to us, though, God. And so this morning we're asking that you would do that very thing. Teach us by your word, for it is good as you are, O Lord. We extol your goodness and your grace this morning. May Christ be big today at CBC. In Jesus' name, amen.
Everyone needs Well, this is our time in our service where we would normally pass our offering plates. If you're visiting with us and don't know, we've got a couple of boxes there at the door that you are able to drop your offering in as you leave the service at the end of the service today. Or you can also give online or also by mail, but provide a couple opportunities for you to be able to give. So let's go to the Lord in prayer for this morning's offering. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to come together, Father, and just worship you. And as part of that worship, being able to give back to you a portion of what you have given to us, Father. We ask that you would just bless these tithes that are being given today, Father, and continue just to give this leadership wisdom and how we oversee those gifts. And it's in your son's name we pray. Amen. Our mission focus this morning is on the Genesis Center here in Kaufman. We support the Genesis Center financially each month through our Faith Challenge giving. And it's a ministry that helps women and children, their children that... The children of the ladies who are there in need, who have suffered possibly abuse in the home or in the marriage, or maybe even some type of a dependency abuse. So we want to continue to lift up that ministry in prayer. One of the prayer requests that they had this week is they do have a lady there that has been infected with COVID and is isolated there at the center, and so they're asking that we pray that it does not spread. Those ladies are in close confinement anyway, and they do everything together quite often, so it's definitely going to be a challenge. But not one that the Lord can't handle. So let's be lifting them up in prayer. Also, we received word that Jamie Wright has also contracted COVID. So let's lift up Jamie and his family as they go through this. He's running fever and just overall doesn't feel great. But nothing more serious. So we're thankful for that. Let's continue to lift up Jamie during this time. Also, Loretta Williamson has been diagnosed with pulmonary fibrosis combined with COPD, which she had already been diagnosed with. So her breathing has become very difficult. She's going to be seeing a specialist, and so we want to be praying that the doctors would give them wisdom in how to treat and come up with a treatment plan that would help bring much relief for Loretta. Also, there's many others there in our bulletin. An update on Denver, the medication that he was receiving for the seizures was not effective. It has quit working, so they have changed it to a different medication that has more serious side effects. So let's pray that those side effects, he does not experience those side effects, and that the medication would be effective, and just continue to pray for his parents. And I encourage you just to lift all these up that are in our bulletin. Again, there's many suffering with different types of cancer, from leukemia to pancreatic cancer, and just other different types of cancers. Let's be lifting them up in prayer this morning as we go to the Lord. I'm going to allow you some time to pray, and I'll close us. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, once again, we're so grateful that we can come to you, that we can bring our needs before you, that we can lay our burdens down at your feet, Father, that you take them from us when we give them to you, Father. Father, I ask this morning that you would be with the women at the Genesis Center, especially the lady who is going through the COVID. And Father, just ask that you would heal her quickly. Father, we do ask that you would protect the other ladies and the children there in the center from getting this. And Father, just that you would continue just to watch over all of them during this time. Father, protect her health from any serious side effects, and just restore her health quickly, Father. Father, we do want to continue just to lift up the Genesis Center's ministry overall. Father, we thank you so much for their passion for helping women be able to turn their lives around, Father, introducing them to you, and Father, discipling them, and Father, just getting them back on their feet. We've seen so many testimonies of ladies' lives changed by you, Father, through what they do. Father, may we continue to support them, not only financially, but throughout the years. Needs arise, and Father, just continue just to bless that ministry. Father, we do want to lift up Jamie to you this morning. Father, we ask that his symptoms not become worse, and that that they would clear up quickly, Father, just that you would heal him. Father, protect Melanie and the girls from getting it, and Father, just put your arms around them right now, and just protect them, Father. Father, we do ask just that you would get rid of this virus overall. Father, just protect us all. It just seems like more and more people that we know are coming down with it, Father, and just protect each one, Father. Father, I do want to pray for Loretta as she awaits to see the specialist, Father. I do thank you for revealing this other issue, but on the other hand, Father, we ask that you would just take that from her, Father, just that you would help her to breathe with ease, and Father, just that the doctors would know exactly what to do to treat the symptoms, and be able to give her breath freely, Father. And Father, just continue to be with Joe and, of course, Lori and Ron and the family as they continue to help Loretta during this time, Father. Father, we do want to continue to lift up those in our bulletin that are fighting cancer, Father, from leukemia to pancreatic cancer to spinal cancer, Father, just ask that you would just do a miracle in their lives, Father, and remove this thing that's attacking their bodies, Father. We ask that the treatments be successful, and Father, just that you would give strength where strength is needed, that you would give hunger so that their bodies would be able to get nourishment, Father, just that you would protect their muscles from atrophy, and Father, just be with their families as they walk this journey with them, Father. Father, we do lift up little Denver and ask that you would just continue to give the doctors wisdom in treating what's going on, just that they would be able to find what's causing all this somehow. And Father, just that you would heal his little body. Be with his parents. This is such a draining time, meeting all his daily physical needs, Father, and just the worry, Father, that they could place it at your feet, let you carry it. Father, we ask that you would be with us this morning as we continue to worship you. Father, may we come and be broken, repentant of anything going on in our lives, Father, that's not of you, Father, and just that we would lay them at your feet, Father. Thank you for sending your Son to die on the cross for us, that we could bring our burdens to you, Father. Help us to worship you in song and word this morning. It's in your Son's name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name.
So glad for that, the immovable rock that we stand on. Bridget looked at me yesterday and she said, I'm tired of these masks. Do you agree? Yeah. Tim prayed about this thing that we're going through. But we're going to sing this song, Death Was Arrested. And I want to read this passage before we sing it, because there will be a day where all of this will be gone. Do you believe that? Not just this thing with COVID, but all of the sin and death that pervades our world, your struggle with your flesh, all of that is going to be gone one day. So before we sing this song, I just want to remind you of something you already know. Paul told the church at Corinth. He said, I tell you, brothers, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable. We shall be changed. Paul later says we will be a new creation. We will be changed, for this perishable body must put on the imperishable, and this mortal body must put on immortality. When the perishable puts on the imperishable and the mortal puts on immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that it is written. And here it is. Death is swallowed up in victory in this solid rock that we just sang about. That our hope is found in nothing less than Christ and this rock where death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. So as we sing this song about death being arrested, where is your victory? Oh, we're free. As we sing this song, remember what God tells us in His Word. And that we have hope. Not a hope that something might happen, but a hope that something will happen. And your imperishable body will be, your perishable body will be exchanged for an imperishable one. And we will live with Christ forever.
Sorrow and death, my sin, lost without hope, no place to live. Your love made a way, let mercy come in. When death was arrested, my life began. Ash was redeemed, only beauty remained. When death was arrested, my life began. Oh, your grace, so free, washes over me. You have made me new, now life began with you. It's your
As you turn to Daniel chapter 2, I'll let you know I'm going to be out of town for 2 weeks, and I'm excited because I've got a couple of guest speakers for you in those 2 weeks. The first one, Richard Dunn, is coming to preach to you next week from the center. He is the director at the center, what we used to call the Help Center, and he was actually scheduled to come preach to us on the very first Sunday that we had to completely cancel our services when COVID hit, and we didn't know what all was happening. And so finally, 6 months later, get to have him back. So he'll be here. He's always so great to hear from. Definitely a student of the Word and just very passionate about Christ, and we'll have a lot to say. And then, the next week after that, our very own Richard Dominguez is going to be sharing with you, which is very, very exciting as well. And so I do hope you'll be here for that first Sunday of October. When I get back, we'll be right back into Daniel chapter 3 in the fiery furnace. But today we're in Daniel chapter 2, which if you read ahead at all, you know is pretty lengthy. We believe in the Word here and its power, and so we're going to read it together. So take a deep breath, maybe stretch out a little bit, because here we go. Daniel chapter 2, verse 1. In the second year of the reign of Nebuchadnezzar, Nebuchadnezzar had dreams. His spirit was troubled and his sleep left him. Then the king commanded that the magicians, the enchanters, the sorcerers, and the Chaldeans be summoned to tell the king his dreams. So they came in and stood before the king. And the king said to them, I had a dream, and my spirit is troubled to know the dream. Then the Chaldeans said to the king in Aramaic, O king, live forever. Tell your servants the dream, and we will show the interpretation. The king answered and said to the Chaldeans, the word from me is firm. If you do not make known to me the dream and its interpretation, you shall be torn limb from limb, and your houses shall be laid in ruins. But if you show the dream and its interpretation, you shall receive from me gifts and rewards and great honor. Therefore, show me the dream and its interpretation. They answered a second time and said, let the king tell his servants the dream, and we will show its interpretation. The king answered and said, I know with certainty that you are trying to gain time, because you see that the word from me is firm. If you do not make the dream known to me, there is but one sentence for you. You have agreed to speak lying and corrupt words before me till the times change. Therefore, tell me the dream, and I shall know that you can show me its interpretation. The Chaldeans answered the king and said, there is not a man on earth who can meet the king's demand. For no great and powerful king has asked such a thing of any magician or enchanter or Chaldean. The thing that the king asks is difficult, and no one can show it to the king except the gods, whose dwelling is not with flesh. Because of this, the king was angry and very furious and commanded that all the wise men of Babylon be destroyed. So the decree went out, and the wise men were about to be killed, and they sought Daniel and his companions to kill them. Then Daniel replied with prudence and discretion to Arioch, the captain of the king's guard, who had gone out to kill the wise men of Babylon. He declared to Arioch, the king's captain, why is the decree of the king so urgent? Then Arioch made the matter known to Daniel, and Daniel went in and requested the king to appoint him a time that he might show the interpretation to the king. Then Daniel went to his house and made the matter known to Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, his companions, and told them to seek mercy from the God of heaven concerning this mystery, so that Daniel and his companions might not be destroyed with the rest of the wise men of Babylon. Then the mystery was revealed to Daniel in a vision of the night. Then Daniel blessed the God of heaven. He answered and said, blessed be the name of God forever and ever, to whom belong wisdom and might. He changes times and seasons. He removes kings and sets up kings. He gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to those who have understanding. He reveals deep and hidden things. He knows what is in the darkness, and the light dwells with him. To you, O God of my fathers, I give thanks and praise, for you have given me wisdom and might, and have now made known to me what we asked of you, for you have made known to us the king's matter. Therefore Daniel went in to Arioch, whom the king had appointed to destroy the wise men of Babylon. He went and said thus to him, do not destroy the wise men of Babylon. Bring me in before the king, and I will show the king the interpretation. Then Arioch brought in Daniel before the king in haste and said thus to him, I have found among the exiles from Judah a man who will make known to the king the interpretation. The king declared to Daniel, whose name was Belteshazzar, are you able to make known to me the dream that I have seen and its interpretation? Daniel answered the king and said, no wise men, enchanters, magicians, or astrologers can show to the king the mystery that the king has asked. But there is a God in heaven who reveals mystery. And he has made known to King Nebuchadnezzar what will be in the latter days. Your dream and the visions of your head as you lay in bed are these. To you, O king, as you lay in bed, came thoughts of what would be after this. And he who reveals mysteries made known to you what is to be. But as for me, this mystery has been revealed to me, not because of any wisdom that I have, more than all the living, but in order that the interpretation may be known to the king, and that you may know the thoughts of your mind. You saw, O king, and behold, a great image. This image, mighty and of exceeding brightness, stood before you, and its appearance was frightening. The head of this image was of fine gold, its chest and arms of silver, its middle and thighs of bronze, its legs of iron, its feet partly of iron and partly of clay. As you looked, a stone was cut out by no human hand, and it struck the image on its feet of iron and clay and broke them in pieces. Then the iron, the clay, the bronze, the silver, and the gold all together were broken in pieces and became like the chaff of the summer threshing floors. And the wind carried them away so that not a trace of them could be found. With the stone that struck the image became a great mountain and filled the whole earth. This was the dream. Now we will tell the king its interpretation. You, O king, the king of kings, to whom the God of heaven has given the kingdom, the power and the might and the glory, and into whose hand he has given wherever they dwell, the children of man, the beasts of the field and the birds of the heavens, making you rule over them all, you are the head of gold. Another kingdom inferior to you shall arise after you, and yet a third kingdom of bronze, which shall rule over all the earth. And there shall be a fourth kingdom, strong as iron, because iron breaks to pieces and shatters all things. And like iron that crushes, it shall break and crush all these. And as you saw the feet and toes, partly of potter's clay and partly of iron, it shall be a divided kingdom. But some of the firmness of iron shall be in it, just as you saw iron mixed with the soft clay. And as the toes of the feet were partly iron and partly clay, so the kingdom shall be partly strong and partly brittle. As you saw the iron mixed with soft clay, so they will mix with one another in marriage, but they will not hold together, just as iron does not mix with clay. And in the days of those kings, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom that shall never be destroyed, nor shall the kingdom be left to another people. It shall break in pieces all these kingdoms and bring them to an end, and it shall stand forever, just as you saw that a stone was cut from a mountain by no human hand, and that it broke in pieces the iron, the bronze, the clay, the silver, and the gold. A great God has made known to the king what shall be after this. The dream is certain and its interpretation sure. Then King Nebuchadnezzar fell upon his face and paid homage to Daniel and commanded that an offering and incense be offered up to him. The king answered and said to Daniel, "Truly your God is God of gods and Lord of kings and a revealer of mysteries, for you have been able to reveal this mystery." Then the king gave Daniel high honors and many great gifts and made him rule over the whole province of Babylon and chief prefect over all the wise men of Babylon. Daniel made a request of the king, and he appointed Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego over the affairs of the province of Babylon. But Daniel remained at the king's court. Well done. So, you might look at that and think, that's just too much information. And there is such a thing as too much information. The ways that we convey information about certain things to each other is going to vary from person to person. My wife and I, for instance, have very different modes of conveying information to each other. I generally will tell a couple of basic things about maybe something that's happened in my day. Don't think everything else is real necessary to the point of whatever has happened, whatever's encapsulated in my day. In contrast to that, when she wants to describe things that are going on, she tells me everything. Every detail she gives. And it's great. It is. She thinks I need to know everything. And in her mind and heart, she does. And so I appreciate that and I take it in. But we convey information to each other quite a bit differently. There's a difference in what we think each other needs to know. And when God conveys information, it's clear that he does not convey it all to everyone at the same time and in the same way. Indeed, some things God doesn't tell everyone at all. God is the keeper of all knowledge, of the world, of himself, of humanity, of the future. It's up to him how all that knowledge is disseminated, which can kind of drive us nuts, if we're honest. For instance, right now, we'd really like to know how this whole pandemic thing works out, wouldn't we? It'd be really nice. Shouldn't we know that, God? It's one of those things we think, God should kind of give us like little hints as to how this is going to go. But apparently, at least not yet, this is not need-to-know information for us. Why don't we know everything there is to know? Should we know everything there is to know? Why do some people have more knowledge than others? The second chapter of Daniel highlights a God who very clearly has a say over all the world's knowledge. And it gives us hints about what he decides that we need to know and what he decides that we don't, which is freeing for us, and it's humbling for us. It's humbling because we recognize in that we aren't ultimately in control of how much we know, and that there might be some things that we can't explain as much as we'd like to. It's freeing to us because we're reminded that since we don't know it all, we don't have to be the ones to explain it all the time. That's free. Indeed, what we see today from this passage is that knowledge is a gift, not an entitlement. Knowledge is a gift, not an entitlement. And I don't mean it's a gift in the sense of a spiritual gift. I mean it's a gift in the sense that it's something that is given, that you are not necessarily entitled to. To know anything is a gift. God graciously allows you to know a lot, some more than others. About himself, it's graciously revealed much. About the world, much. About others, about your future, some things. But you're not entitled to know everything. And in fact, there's a lot that you don't get to know. A lot that I don't get to know. And that's actually a really good thing. We only know what God wants us to know. Okay, it seems very basic, but it's true. We only know what God wants us to know. There is nothing that you can find out about anything that God has not first revealed to you. Whether that's just general knowledge, or it's very special, specific knowledge. See that here, because we know that Nebuchadnezzar would not have known a thing about his dream if God had not revealed it to him, right? Nor would he have even had the dream to begin with. Look at verse 1 again. In the second year of the reign of Nebuchadnezzar, he had dreams. It's very simple. Nebuchadnezzar had dreams. His spirit was troubled and his sleep left him. Then the king commanded that the magicians, enchanters, sorcerers, Chaldeans be summoned to tell him his dreams. So they came and stood before him. And the king said, I have had a dream, and my spirit is troubled to know the dream. Sounds very passive, but in it we can see the hand of God. Last week was our introduction to the situation of the exiles. So we're calling this series Exiled, right? The exiles were the people of Judah who we had seen prophesied in Habakkuk would be taken captive and brought to Babylon, exiled from their land. And now we're just a little way into the reign of Nebuchadnezzar. And the text says he had dreams. Now, dreams were pretty big deals in that culture. When those things happen, people paid a lot of attention. And so Nebuchadnezzar really wants that figured out. So he gets all his wise men together. You notice one phrase in there, sorcerers, enchanters, and Chaldeans. We've used that term a lot equal with Babylonians, right? Here it's probably more of a term that's set aside as a specific set of wise men that they just kind of began to have a catch-all term, Chaldean, for. So there's lots of different wise men, astrologers, diviners in the court. It's clear that God gave Nebuchadnezzar this dream. Why? In order to orchestrate all the things that were going to happen next. Nebuchadnezzar would not have had any special knowledge of the world events that God was about to give him without God delivering those things to him in a dream. Would have been impossible. Nebuchadnezzar had no control in gaining any of this information. Even the information that was given to him, he did not go out and get. It came to him in a dream. You see how passive that is. And he had no idea what it meant either. So Nebuchadnezzar would not have known were it not for God to reveal it, nor would anyone else have known anything about his dream if not revealed by God. The whole first half of Daniel chapter 2 is about the futile search for knowledge of anything apart from God. That's what it's about. It's completely futile. Go searching for whatever you want to know, but search for it apart from God. Ain't gonna work. Here are some words to watch for in this chapter as we read the next little section. Watch for these words. The word show. The word, or the phrase, make known. The word reveal. Okay, let's look at these together. Look at verse 4. Then the Chaldeans said to the king in Aramaic, O king, live forever. Tell your servants the dream, and we will show the interpretation. The king answered and said to the Chaldeans, "The word from me is firm. If you do not make known to me the dream and its interpretation, you shall be torn limb from limb, and your houses shall be laid in ruins. But if you show the dream and its interpretation, you shall receive from me gifts and rewards of great honor. Therefore, show me the dream and its interpretation." They answered the king a second time and said, "Let the king tell his servants the dream, and we will show its interpretation." The king answered and said, "I know with certainty that you're trying to gain time, because you see that the word from me is firm. If you do not make the dream known to me, there is but one sentence for you. You've agreed to speak lying and corrupt words before me till the times change. Therefore, tell me the dream, and I shall know that you can show me its interpretation." The Chaldeans answered the king and said, "There's not a man on earth who can meet the king's demand, for no great and powerful king has asked such a thing of any magician or enchanter or Chaldean. The thing that the king asks is difficult, and no one can show it to the king except the gods whose dwelling is not with flesh." You saw them there. The word for show or declare is hava. It's in this text from in Daniel 2, 10 times. The word make known is yeda. It's in the text 10 times. The word for reveal, we didn't see it in this passage, but it comes 6 times later. It's gala, reveal. So keep watching for these words as we work our way through this chapter. Show, make known, reveal. These are hints as to what is going on here. The whole first half of the chapter, really the whole chapter, is about the futile search for knowledge, showing, making known, being revealed. Futile search for anything apart from God. We saw in verse 4 that the language shifts to Aramaic. You may have noticed that. They said to the king in Aramaic. What's relayed after that, all the way through the end of chapter 7, becomes Aramaic. It's one of those kind of, most people don't realize that the Bible was written in more than just Greek and Hebrew. There are some parts, such as Daniel, parts of it that are written in Aramaic, which is kind of cool. Even up to Jesus' day, Aramaic was the common language of the day, so it makes sense that some would be in Hebrew, some in Aramaic. And they say in Aramaic, verse 4, "O king, live forever." Now, we have read through this whole thing here. We've read through the dream and its interpretation, so we can look back at their words and see a little bit of ironic foreshadowing, right? It serves to show, when they say, "O king, live forever," shows that they have no idea what this dream is about, because if they had any inkling of what it was about, they would have known this dream is about how Nebuchadnezzar's reign isn't going to last all that long. That the kingdom of Babylon is going to be shattered and crushed to pieces and blown away like chaff of the wind. They don't know. They can't make anything known. They can't reveal anything. They can't show it. But he really wants them to. "Make known to me the dream," he says in verse 5. In other words, tell me the dream. Nebuchadnezzar is not going to tell them what the dream is, so that they couldn't just make up an interpretation. If you come to me, maybe in my office, sit down on the couch and like, "Man, I had this dream," and you spill it to me, I can give you some sort of interpretation. I can give it. But if you tell me, "Hey, tell me my dream and the interpretation," I got nothing. They confess, "There's not a man on earth who could do that." That's verse 10. Not only are the diviners, the astrologers, whoever, helpless, so is Nebuchadnezzar. They are helpless to know anything apart from Yahweh. And they even add in verse 11, the gods, though, could do it. They see that it's going to take some sort of divinity for any sort of revelation to be made known here. But Nebuchadnezzar's question to them could very simply be at that point, then why don't the gods reveal it to me? If the gods gave me this dream, why don't they give me a revelation? Well, the gods aren't telling me anything. Why not? Well, besides the obvious fact that the gods don't exist, it's because no one, Daniel wants us to understand, can know the dream or its interpretation apart from revelation from Yahweh, the one true God. And so, all the king can do at this point, all he has the power to do with this, is say, "All right, I'll just kill everyone instead." That's all he's got. Verse 12. "Because of this, the king was very angry and very furious and commanded that all the wise men of Babylon be destroyed. And so the decree went out and the wise men were about to be killed and they sought Daniel and his companions to kill them." That's because they were part of this group. They had been trained for 3 years. right, in Babylon, astrology or divining or whatever all it was, they were part of this deal. But Daniel offers to take a chance at interpreting. Verse 14, Daniel replied with prudence and discretion to Arioch, the captain of the king's guard, who'd gone out to kill the wise men of Babylon. He declared to Arioch, the king's captain, why is the decree of the king so urgent? Like, slow down, man. It's okay. Then Arioch made the matter known to Daniel, and Daniel went in and requested the king to appoint him a time that he might show the interpretation to the king. Now, appoint, if you remember that the word natan from last week that we looked at several times in chapter 1, that word give, it's the same word here for appoint, natan. This is very much a dig at Nebuchadnezzar's sovereignty. Okay, Daniel's saying, hey, Nebuchadnezzar can appoint me a time, but that's all that he can appoint. Only God's going to be able to give or appoint me the dream and the interpretation. That Daniel then, at this point, prays and asks his friends to pray too is also there for a purpose in the story. Why? Why right here does he stop and pray and we have this beautiful prayer right in the middle? It's to show that Daniel would have had no idea either, just like everybody else in this story would have had no idea about this dream or its interpretation if God had not given it to him, revealed it to him. Verse 17, Daniel went to his house then. Notice that word then at the beginning. I skipped it, but it's there. They're making connection here. Then Daniel went to his house and made the matter known to Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, his companions, and told them to seek mercy from God, the God of heaven, concerning this mystery, so that Daniel and his companions might not be destroyed with the rest of the wise men of Babylon. Then the mystery was, there's the word, revealed to Daniel in a vision of the night. Then Daniel blessed the God of heaven, and we'll get to that prayer momentarily, but look at the end of the prayer, where he says in verse 23, to you, O God of my fathers, I give thanks and praise, for you have given me wisdom and might, and have now made known to me what we've asked of you, for you have made known to us the king's matter. He says to his friends, friends, please, 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 seek mercy. Seek mercy from God on this. In other words, hey, Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, we don't deserve to know this. We don't deserve this information. We're not entitled to it in one bit. We need the mercy of God here. We need something that we don't deserve to be given to us, which is the revelation of this mystery. Seek mercy because he has no idea. Daniel has no idea about the dream or its interpretation at this point. It's like me trying to tell some of you what you had for breakfast this morning and then explaining what in the world that has to do about who you are, what God's trying to tell you through your breakfast. I can tell you that if you had like something like a frosted blueberry Pop-Tart, God's telling you something good. This showed Daniel's utter reliance on God, that he would stop, that he would pray, that he would do this asking for mercy. Because as great as Daniel is and was with dreams, and we'll see it even more as we go through Daniel, he's great with dreams. Why? It's only because God made him so. Key words, we saw him in those verses where he was praying, where he was asking for prayer. Revealed. It was revealed. Oh God, you made it known. Oh God, you made it known. And as if all of that isn't enough to convince us about the need for revelation from God, Daniel explains God very clearly and theologically as the mystery revealer. Verse 24, therefore Daniel went in to Arioch, whom the king had appointed to destroy the wise men of Babylon. He went and said thus to him, do not destroy the wise men of Babylon. Bring me in before the king, and I will show the king the interpretation. Then Arioch brought in Daniel before the king in haste and said thus to him, I have found among the exiles from Judah a man who will make known to the king the interpretation. The king declared to Daniel, whose name was Belteshazzar, are you able to make known to me the dream that I have seen and its interpretation? Daniel answered the king and said, no wise men, enchanters, magicians, or astrologers can show to the king the mystery that the king has asked. But there is a God in heaven who reveals mysteries, and he has made known to King Nebuchadnezzar what will be in the latter days. Your dream and the visions of your head as you lay in bed are these. To you, O king, as you lay in bed came thoughts of what would be after this. And he who reveals mysteries made known to you what is to be. But for me, this mystery has been revealed to me, not because of any wisdom that I have, more than all the living, but in order that the interpretation may be made known to the king. Daniel cannot help but give God all the credit. He reveals mysteries. He makes them known. He shows the king. He does. This God in heaven. When Arioch says in verse 25, I have found the guy. You can't help but chuckle there. It's just dripping with irony. Arioch hadn't found Daniel. God had brought Daniel to Arioch. And everyone reading this knows it. Arioch didn't discover anything at all. Another thing that God had to reveal to someone, had to show him. And as Daniel says in verse 27, no wise men, astrologers, enchanters, whoever could reveal this dream. At this point, any astrological powers that these guys had, maybe spiritual forces of evil that we believe, yeah, that's happening. Any powers that they may have had to divine things that they may have drawn from the powers of darkness was right now just completely blocked. They could not use it. Why? So it would be very clear, crystal, when God intervened. Could not be attributed to anyone else but him. So that he would be seen as the keeper of knowledge that he is. Even Nebuchadnezzar, he didn't even know the thoughts, Daniel says, of his own mind without God revealing them to him. Look at the very end of verse 30. Why was this revealed to me, Daniel says, that you may know the thoughts of your mind. And even Nebuchadnezzar finally realized that the knowledge that he was seeking could only come from Yahweh. Let's skip all the way past the dream for the moment. We'll come back to it, but we'll go to verse 46. After it's all explained, Nebuchadnezzar says, fell upon his face, paid homage to Daniel, commanded that an offering of incense be offered up to him. The king answered and said to Daniel, truly your God is God of gods and Lord of kings and a revealer of mysteries. For you have been able to reveal this mystery. Title one that he gives to God is Lord of Kings. That's a step up, I think, from when Daniel calls Nebuchadnezzar, you're the king of kings, Nebuchadnezzar. He's like, ooh, there's a lord over all these kings. Title two, he gives him that we look at revealer of mysteries. Revealer, revealed. Even Nebuchadnezzar knows it. That I could not have come upon this information. I was not entitled to this information. Would not have been given to me, revealed to me apart from Yahweh, God. And then the title that really flows through this chapter, pops up again and again and again. It's used several times by Daniel, is the God of Heaven. It's an unusual title for God, not used very commonly. And I think it's very much a dig at the heavens-gazing astrologers. What did they do? They looked up to the heavens, looked at the stars, and tried to figure out what in the world the stars meant that would tell them what's going on. And they've got nothing. Daniel says, hey, there's a God up there. He's going to reveal it. Nebuchadnezzar, Daniel, everyone only knew what God wanted them to know. And it's the same for us. We only know what God wants us to know. Anything that you know, any knowledge or understanding you have about anything, it is because God has revealed it to you. About yourself, if you have any sort of self-awareness, if you have any understanding of what your strengths are or your weaknesses are, if you have any knowledge about the world, the processes of the world or the systems of the world, if you have any knowledge about your work or in your home, maybe the expertise you have on your field or the discipleship that you've developed to be able to pass on to the next generation, any knowledge or wisdom you have about other people, any time you can discern what's happening in their lives, any time you might offer someone some wisdom. Anything that you know, it's because God has revealed that to you. And so here's the thing, friends. If you know some stuff about some things, be humble about it. For God has the storehouse of wisdom. Look at verse 20, back when Daniel was praying. We didn't read it before. Daniel answered and said, when it was revealed to him, blessed be the name of God forever and ever, to whom belong wisdom and might. He changes times and seasons. He removes and sets up kings. Daniel's like, God has the market of knowledge cornered. Like people who bought up stuff when COVID hit because they knew, hey, I'm going to sell this at a premium. Who in the world got all the ham so that Domino's wouldn't even put it on my pizza? God had the market cornered, has the market cornered on knowledge. This prayer that Daniel prays is the theological center of this chapter. It is the crux of what the author is trying to show us with this story. That God has the storehouse of wisdom, and God gives to his people from out of that storehouse. That's how it works. Look at the end of verse 21. He gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to those who have understanding. Friends, you would know nothing if it wasn't for God's revelation. Or let's state it more positively. Let's be a little more cheery now. You know exactly what God wants you to know. That's positive. It's awesome. Because God is not stingy with knowledge. He's not a knowledge miser, just storing it up, stacking up the knowledge and keeping it away from everyone. Rather, God is graciously liberal in giving it out. And you get some knowledge, and you get some knowledge, and you. He's giving it out. Revealing deep things. Look at verse 22. He reveals deep and hidden things. God wants to dole out more wisdom and knowledge and understanding. And his decisions about what knowledge to distribute and when to distribute it and to whom he will distribute that knowledge, those decisions are praiseworthy. That's why Daniel, verse 20, says, blessed be the name of God forever and ever, to whom belong wisdom and might. And then in verse 23, to you, O God of my fathers, I give thanks and praise, for you've given me wisdom. It's praiseworthy. The way God gives his wisdom, his knowledge. Now, there are some theological corollaries that I want to think through in regards to this. Okay, if anything that we know is because God has revealed it to us, if we would not know anything apart from God revealing it to us, if we can say that God tells us exactly what we need to know, there are some things theologically we have to think through. The first one is this. Some things God reveals to everyone. Okay, very clearly. Some things God reveals to everyone. We call that general revelation. Okay, example from this story. Everyone in this circumstance here in Daniel chapter 2 knew that Nebuchadnezzar had a dream. They knew it because Nebuchadnezzar told everybody. That was general revelation that God apparently allowed everyone here in Babylon to know. How about an example from our world of general revelation that everyone knows? That would be the common grace of the senses. Right? What you can take in through touch and taste and smell and sight. Those things that you can take in that way, everyone else who has that sense or those senses, they can take those things in too. They can know those things. God allows that. An example from Scripture is in Romans chapter 1. What can be known about God is plain to them. And Paul's talking about them in terms of every single person on the world. Because God has shown it to them. For his invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world in the things that have been made. Paul says, the fact that God exists and what God is like, those things he has revealed to all. That is general revelation. God reveals some things to everyone. But corollary two, God reveals other things only to some, doesn't he? We call that special revelation. Example from this story, if we think about it. Everyone knew that Nebuchadnezzar had a dream. Not everyone knew what Nebuchadnezzar's dream was and what it meant. Very clear. That was special revelation that God only allowed Daniel to know. That was it, just him. And then eventually, the others who were there as well. Knowledge is a gift. It's not an entitlement. Everyone there wasn't entitled to know the dream and its interpretation. It was gifted to Daniel. Example from Scripture now, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 6. God, who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," has shone in our hearts. Now Paul is talking about believers, our hearts, to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. All believers have had the knowledge of the glory of God revealed to us by God in the face of Christ, the person of Jesus. All believers have had the knowledge of the glory of God revealed to us by God in the person of Jesus. And so to us has been revealed what needs to be known, all that is needed to be known for faith, which to unbelievers, this verse implies, has not yet been revealed. Their eyes blinded to the glory of God until God chooses to reveal it. Special revelation. And we can even think a little bit further. All believers may have been gifted with the knowledge of the glory of God, but not all believers have the same understanding of everything pertaining to God. Right? You can say that. Not all believers have the same understanding of everything pertaining to all areas of the world, or all areas of their work, or all areas of each other. We know and understand at different levels. Example from Scripture, 1 Corinthians chapter 8 says that Paul puts it this way, not all possessed the knowledge of what? That it didn't really matter whether or not Christians ate food that was sacrificed to idols, but that it was a matter of conscience. Not everyone possessed that knowledge, he said. They were all believers. They all had knowledge of God, the glory of God revealed in the person of Christ. But they didn't quite possess the same knowledge in relation to the theological corollaries of it. Other example, why in the world does Paul constantly pray in the epistles for more and more knowledge and discernment for his churches? Because we grow in those things. Other things God reveals only to some, which I think is encouraging. Because it means, friends, that it's okay for you to say those three nasty words every once in a while. I don't know. Say it. Let's practice it. Can you say it with me? Ready? I don't know. Yeah, you did a good job. It's okay to say that sometimes. You don't know it all. And you don't have to. And the fact that we learn at different times, different levels, that God grants wisdom and knowledge and doles it out how he wishes, that should keep you, friends, from condemning those who might not be where you are. And when it comes to what they should know about God, when it comes to anything else that you have in common, be patient with one another. Teach and guide one another. Corollary 3. Some things God has decided we need to know. Some things God has decided we need to know. And the knowledge of those things is a gift. It's a gift. Example in our reading of this story. Question for you. What has God clearly decided that we need to know via this story? Well, several things. How Daniel dealt with the situation. It's very clear we need to know that. How God showed himself greater than any false god out there. We need to know that. How Israel was protected through Daniel and company. We need to know it. That Nebuchadnezzar's rule was going to end, and that there would be other kingdoms that would come along, and that there would be other kingdoms who would be smashed to pieces by one kingdom. We need to know that. Those things were of greatest importance to the original audience who read this or heard it taught to them. And then to the generations to come who would read it in Israel. And then to the church later on, us today reading it. We need to know those things very clearly. Another example. The point of Nebuchadnezzar's dream. And we're going to see this as we move through Daniel. The point of Nebuchadnezzar's dream was not to grant us knowledge of an end times outline. It was to encourage God's people through the ages that God's kingdom was superior to any other kingdom. And that it would outlast every earthly kingdom of every age. That was the point. That was the purpose. Verse 31. You saw, O king, and behold, a great image. Here we go. The image, mighty and of exceeding brightness, stood before you, and its appearance was frightening. The head of this image was of fine gold, its chest and arms of silver, its middle and thighs of bronze, its legs of iron, its feet partly of iron, partly of clay. As you looked, a stone was cut out by no human hand, and it struck the image on its feet of iron and clay and broke them into pieces. Then the iron, the clay, the bronze, the silver, and the gold all together were broken in pieces and became like the chaff of the summer threshing floors. And the wind carried them away so that not a trace of them could be found. But the stone that struck the image became a great mountain and filled the whole earth. The point of Nebuchadnezzar's dream was not to grant us a knowledge of an end times outline, but to encourage God's people through the ages that God's kingdom was superior to all earthly kingdoms and would outlast them all. So, what I want you to know, friends, is that you ought to focus your study of the Word on the things that you need to know. Not on the things that are probably meant to be mysteries. You could break down every single... What is iron made up of? What is the element of clay? How does that work together? You could break that down. You could probably find something with it and write a book about it. That doesn't mean you need to know it. And it doesn't mean you're going to discover the right things. Titus chapter 3, verse 9. Avoid foolish controversies, genealogies, dissensions, and quarrels about the law, for they are unprofitable and worthless. Be careful with these visions as we go through them together, friends. We'll talk about them, but be careful. Focus your study on the things that you know you need to know. There are some things that men just aren't meant to understand about women, right? But there are plenty of things that we certainly are meant to understand about them. And so, men, we should seek to become experts in what? The things that we don't need to know, or the things that we know we do need to know? Focus your study here, not fruitlessly spending your time on the other. Do, guys, do focus on gaining knowledge. You have access to a lot of knowledge that God has in his storehouse, that he has determined that you need to know. And he's passing it out liberally to believers who are digging for it. Do it. You probably have access to things that you have never even tried to gain in your life. Get deeper. Do you dig? Do that. God, it says in verse 22, reveals deep and hidden things. Human life and history is not something that is subject to the movement of stars or planets. That's just to be guessed at. I wonder what's going to happen. I wonder what's going to happen there. I wonder what God's doing here. No, it's something that is clearly, this passage shows, controlled by God. What we can try to anticipate about our human present and our human future, we know ultimately from what? From the revelation. There is no confidence for you in current knowledge. There's no confidence for you in current anticipation of the future apart from immersing yourself in the Bible, where God reveals mysteries. Are you content with scratching the surface of the gold mine of riches that's available to you? Imagine taking a long hike to pan for gold, and 10 minutes in, you find a nugget about the size of a dime, and you're like, yes! And you walk away with it. And you leave everything else. Imagine stopping there. How foolish. There's more. Stay there longer than 10 minutes. Read, study the things that you need to know, and that the Bible is very clear about. And if you lack what you think you need to know, then pray for it. That's exactly what Daniel did. Corollary 4. Okay, there are some things that God has decided that we need to know. There are other things, corollary 4, that God has apparently decided we don't need to know. And that we're not entitled to know. Example, in our reading of this story. What has God apparently decided that we don't need to know via this story? Well, I think it's clear that we don't need to know the specific details of the future. There are some detailed things in here, but they're not specific toward the future exactly to know word for word what's going to match with what. Okay? Daniel says in verse 28, there is a God in heaven who reveals mysteries, is made known to King Nebuchadnezzar what will be in the latter days. That is a very vague phrase. And Daniel means sometime in the future. Sometime after your reign is over, Nebuchadnezzar, it's going to happen. I don't know the specifics of that. Now, let's get on to the interpretation of the dream. Verse 36, this was the dream. Now we will tell the king its interpretation. You, O king, the king of kings, to whom the God of heaven has given the kingdom, the power and the might and the glory, and into whose hand he has given, wherever they dwell, the children of man, beasts of the field, the birds of the heavens, making you rule over them all. You are the head of gold. There, we know that. Another kingdom inferior to you shall arise after you, and yet a third kingdom of bronze, which shall rule over all the earth. Doesn't tell what the kingdoms are. And there shall be a fourth kingdom, strong as iron, because iron breaks to pieces and shatters all things. And like iron that crushes, it shall break and crush all these. And as you saw the feet and toes, partly of potter's clay, partly of iron, it shall be a divided kingdom. Okay, that's clear. But some of the firmness of iron shall be in it, just as you saw iron mixed with soft clay. As the toes of the feet were partly iron and partly clay, so the kingdom shall be partly strong and partly brittle. As you saw the iron mixed with soft clay, so they will mix with one another in marriage, but they will not hold together, just as iron does not mix with clay. Okay. What are these kingdoms? Well, people have been arguing about this for centuries. Some would say, hey, we got four kingdoms here. Very clearly, the first one's Babylon. It's Nebuchadnezzar in Babylon. Because Daniel says it, you're the head of gold, right? But then what do? Well, there's three more kingdoms we have to start naming. Some say Media, and then Persia, and then Greece. Most would say, hey, Media-Persia was one kingdom, but then there's Greece, and then there's Rome. Some even take these four kingdoms to be just reigns of four kings in Babylon. And then what about the stone that comes in verse 35 that struck the image and became a great mountain that filled the earth? Is that far off? Has it already arrived? I believe, seems to me, the most helpful interpretation is that there are four kingdoms. Babylon would be the first one, that's clear. Then probably Media and Persia together as one kingdom, which came right after Babylon. Then Greece, which took over, became a world power. And then Rome, which took over for Greece. The successive world powers in that area of the world leading up to the time of Christ. We'll talk about those more as we move through Daniel, because they will be referenced again. But for now, I want us to see as we read through Daniel chapter 2 is more what in line with what Trimper Longman says. It does not really matter which kingdoms are represented by these medals. They represent successive world powers that dominate the people of God, beginning with Babylon. That's the point. There's going to be other kingdoms that you sit under that are going to be of varying strengths. And then John Goldengay writes it like this. In the drama of the story, the description has to be allowed to remain elusive, meaning it has to be allowed to allude to things, not to where we know exactly what it's going to be. And he finishes with this. People miss the point when they spend time arguing who the empires were. Let's not miss the point. Let's focus on what we know we need to know. The point, very clearly, is not to know the future in detail, but to know that neither Babylon nor any other earthly kingdom would ever or will ever last. That's what the interpretation is for. Daniel says to Nebuchadnezzar in verse 39, there's going to be another kingdom after you. And really in the Aramaic there, after you is it's the very first part. After you. He wants Nebuchadnezzar to know the point. You're not going to last. There's going to be somebody after you. You're going to die. Your kingdom's going to be crushed. He says of all these kingdoms in verse 42, or of the fourth kingdom, it's going to be partly brittle. The point is that no earthly kingdom is going to last forever. All these kingdoms show signs of decay in one way or another. And thus, there is important application for us right now. There should not be any earthly kingdom that we put in our minds that might rise to the point of such greatness in our heads that we think they will last forever, but we should expect that they will decline just as every other kingdom has, to the point that they will never be heard from ever again. Even the great US of A. This statue in this dream represents any and all earthly kingdoms, which is a really good reminder in an election year to ask yourself, which kingdom am I pouring myself into? The details of the future were not of greatest importance to the audience then, nor are they for us now. The vision wasn't set before Nebuchadnezzar for specifics, so that he could somehow jump into action and try to maybe prevent this next kingdom from coming to him. What's going to happen? The Jews there, the Hebrews, they didn't get to know the specifics either. They would read and they would hear this, but that's what they got. And the vision is not set before us now for specifics. That's not the need to know point. Yet, we do need to know some things, and we get to know the generalities of the future. So let's be clear when we're talking about what's going to happen at the end. Let's be clear about the things we know we need to know. Scripture is clear on these three things at the very least. One, Jesus is going to return for his church. Two, we have the hope of a bodily resurrection. And three, there is a certainty of a gloriously perfect new earth. Go back to verse 34. As you looked, Nebuchadnezzar, a stone was cut out by no human hand, and it struck the image on its feet of iron and clay and broke them in pieces. Then the iron, the clay, the bronze, the silver, and the gold all together were broken in pieces and became like the chaff of the summer threshing floors. And the wind carried them away so that not a trace of them could be found. All the earthly kingdoms are going away. But the stone that struck the image became a great mountain and filled the whole earth. Now down to the interpretation, verse 44. And in the days of those kings, all those other kingdoms, he's saying, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom that shall never be destroyed, nor shall the kingdom be left to another people. It shall break in pieces all these kingdoms and bring them to an end, and it shall stand forever. Just as you saw that a stone was cut from a mountain by no human hand, and that it broke in pieces the iron, the bronze, the clay, the silver, and the gold. A kingdom that shall never be destroyed would come. And in the fullness of time, it did. Look what Gabriel, the angel, announced in Luke chapter 1. He, Jesus, that's to be born, will reign over the house of Jacob forever. And of his kingdom there will be no end. Mark chapter 1. Jesus came into Galilee proclaiming the gospel of God and saying, the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. In this vision Daniel has, there is cut out by no human hand. Luke chapter 20 says, what then is this that is written? Jesus is saying, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. Everyone who falls on that stone will be broken to pieces. And when it falls on anyone, it will crush him. Jesus says, that's me. It's alluding to me. So this we get to know, that Christ inaugurated God's kingdom. When he returns, he will crush any remaining earthly kingdoms that may be part for good. The Jews who were reading this got to know what they needed to know, which was that the kingdom was coming. That was need to know. Not the specifics, not the dates, not the emperors. Friends, there might be some things that you need to give up pursuing a knowledge of because you were never meant to know them. That's why, I think, they're called mysteries. That word shows up four times here. Mysteries. God knows we couldn't handle knowing even a speck of what he knows. If we knew all, we would be God, too. We still will not know in heaven, but we will be inquiring every day after day after day, learning more day after day after day, for that is our reward, to learn more of our Savior for eternity. Friends, seek the kingdom. Seek it. Thirst for knowledge. But know that what you learn will only be what God gives. You don't deserve to know it all, but he mercifully allows you to know some. Let's pray. O keeper of all knowledge, guard of the storehouse of wisdom and understanding, we come to you begging for your mercy to know more of who you are and what you have done for us in Christ. God, you have given us as believers everything we need to know to believe in him. And you've drawn many to yourself through that knowledge. And we give you thanks and honor and praise for it. And now, God, we want to be a people who together dig even more deeply into the treasures of gold that lay beneath the surface to understand more of who you are. God, may we not be those who focus on genealogies or dissensions or things that may divide us or may confuse us to the extent that we might give up. But may we look for the things that we know that you have purposed that we need to know and run hard after them. Oh God, we thank you for all that you have given us, growing our minds day after day, and we look to the day when we will know you in an amazing way, in your presence and fullness, learning of you again and again and again for eternity. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
be steeped in unceasing grace, till in death we'll meet on heaven's shore. Oh, that glorious day, 'tis your face I'll see, in your arms I'll see
today. If you would, please wait to be ushed out with your row. If you're on this side, you'll be going to that aisle. If you're on this side, that aisle. We'll start from the back. Please do help us by moving all the way out, heading down the aisle and outside. Promise you'll get to hang out and talk to people as soon as you get out there. But let's get everyone out of here as quickly as we can by not crowding the aisles. That'd be awesome. Let's stop and pray together. May the God of all knowledge and wisdom and understanding grant you to know more of him in the face of Jesus Christ, as you go and you study and you immerse yourself in him this week, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. guys.
Bye.
Thank you everyone for joining us.